And the first speaker is Andreas Schaefer.
Okay, so first I should warn you about this number here. When I came here, I was thinking that I had to give one talk. Then being here, I learned that I should give a double talk, which is now back to a single talk. And at some point, I lost just through that. Yes. So I will simply stop at times. So I was asked to speak a bit about TNPs. Now, you have heard about these calculations already often by now. The unpleasant thing about lattice calculations is that they take very long. No? I mean, it's really a question of years of work. Get computer time, and then calculate everything, analyze everything. So I don't think I have too much new to say, and therefore I extended the topic a little bit to double pattern distributions or multi-particle interactions, which are actually closely related. No? So something we can say that when you know TMDs, you might even know something which is by C. So that's why I added that, and yeah, and let's see how that goes. Also, when preparing, being here, I was asked about some fundamentals of lattice QCD. However, the person who asked me is no longer here. So still, let me rush through that because there are a few points I will come back to during the talk. I mean, first thing is this with this imaginary time and why you can't have light cone links on the lattice. The reason is very simple. That is a generating functional of QCD. And what you do always is that you you analytically continue time to imaginary time, because that basically turns like a Schrödinger equation into a diffusion equation or a quantum theoretical problem in a purely statistical one. Yeah? You see that here, I mean, this S becomes an okay, here you have an additional minus sign in there because T has two time derivatives. So you get another minus sign, and then this becomes something like energy density. And all of, I mean, the whole gets an additional I, and that gives you negative. Yeah? And then you can actually do this just by throwing dice, yeah, which is called Monte Carlo techniques. Yeah? Yeah? And that's basically what you do. Yeah? Now, however, I mean, you cannot integrate over infinitely many degrees of freedom. So Fermion ones you can integrate out completely, and then you get the determinant of the Dirac operator. But the gauge fields, yeah, you have to make to transform into a finite dimensional integral, and that you do by introducing a lattice where you have these various links. So what you are supposed to see is that gauge links are really the fundamental building blocks of lattice QCD. And therefore, if you have any interesting question about properties of gauge links, yeah, for hadrons or for whatever, yeah, then turning to the lattice is always ready. The other point is that because you discretize your interaction, what you actually have is a choice of infinitely many formulations. Yeah? Everything which in the limit A going to zero turns into the continuum QCD, Lagrangian will do. Mm-hmm. And it's actually quite often such that when you look at a certain quantity, you see that one lattice calculations using one action gets results like that if you plot it against A, and the other comes from here, and they meet in one point, and then you really understand what you're doing. But that is the reason why the limit of the continuum limit A going to zero is so essential. Yeah? So lattice calculation where you have not full control about continuum limit is not really state of the art. However, that is a problem, because if you try to make A smaller and smaller, you encounter a famous problem. You typically calculate on periodic lattices, and then you find that the probability to tunnel from one topological sector of QCD to the other becomes smaller and smaller and smaller. That's called diverging autocorrelation time of topological freezing. However, this is only QCD if you sample all topological sectors. And that is a problem which in practice means that you can not really make A smaller than 0.05 Fermi. On the other hand, you don't really want to make it closer than 0.1 Fermi, so you have only a factor of 2 here. And then you want to extrapolate to 0 based on that with numbers which always have error bars. Yeah? And that is one of the great problems to get precise results. And I will come back to that and show what we are doing. I mean, that we is we are the CLS collaboration, which is really a collaboration of collaborations, and that uses open boundary conditions which were introduced by Michel. Okay.
Technical curiosity. Why the flag, one of the flag standards requires that the ratio between the maximum and the minimum lattice spacing that you explore should be larger than 2? If I look at that range...
That's exactly the problem. I mean, normally you would say, I mean, if you have several lattice spacings, but they are all at the same point.
Yeah.
Huh? And so to really have some leverage, for controlled extrapolation, factor 2 is nice. However, I mean, you can always make it closer. You can go to 0.12 or something like that. But that is already about the maximum. So it rather means that, I mean, this thing you don't want to make arbitrarily coarse, or it means that you must go down to at least something like 0.06 or 0.07 or something. Meaning you must have a relatively fine lattice. One should understand that if A becomes smaller by like a factor of 2, you need 16 times more lattice points. No? So it becomes far more expensive. And then what you are doing when you do hadron physics is the following. You put any kind of combination of quark fields or what have you on the lattice at some point, which has the quantum numbers of what you're interested in. And then you propagate the thing in this Euclidean time. And the propagation is simple because it didn't operate as a matrix after discretization. So you have to invert this matrix. Yeah? It's a sparse matrix, luckily. It's basically all zero, except for a few points. And then it's really efficient techniques to invert sparse matrices because that's useful for engineers also. So you do that, and then you can propagate in time, and that means the following. Here, that is any kind of quark combination or quark gluon combination which has the right quantum numbers. So this is, for example, not a nucleon. There's a quantum number of the nucleons, but it's not a nucleon. However, quark gluon states and hadronic states are both basis sets of all hadronic states. And therefore, you can expand this one in a hadronic basis. And then when you propagate in time, you get not e to the I or minus I et, but e to the minus et. And that means that all higher excited states, everything with a higher energy, decays exponentially faster than the quantum state. And therefore, simply by propagating in time, you are singling out the exact complete multiparticle wave function of a hadron. And then you can calculate, I mean, here you see, look, until you get a nice exponential slope, and then you can simply look at any operator you are interested in and divide by what is called the two-point function, just this exponential slope. And there are all kinds of problems I don't want to go into. So, but that's the basic setting of what you're doing. Okay, and then, this all was already told by Matthias to you, so it can be very fast here. So you can apply that to TMDs, and we're actually working on that since 10 years or so, really a long time, and progress is tedious as usual, and Matthias showed you results from the last paper, which I will also do. Now here's a staple-shaped gauge link you have already seen. People have experimented with different forms, but that is the thing which is best under control. Now, how can this all work? Matthias had said this already, the really relevant quantity is here this Polizopa parameter. Now, typically, what you do is you are going to the light cone, where the normal vector along the light cone here, zero, I mean, vector squared is zero, and therefore this diverges. Now, on the lattice, you can't do that, so you make this like a unit vector in space, but then this thing here is invariant mass of your state. Yeah, that's why we often like to look at ions in this context. Yeah, but you can also look at nucleons. So if you make the three-dimensional nucleon momentum sufficiently large, that's the miracle here, then this can also become large. Yeah, even though this is not zero here, but one. And yeah, okay, and then that's these are the configurations used. And I should just say why the calculations are done the way they are done. Because if you calculate these correlators, the ones I've shown, you get corrections both from the soft factor and you get randomization factors. Now, whatever is discussed in the following depends on the validity of the assumption that when you take moments of these, that then in ratios, the soft factors and the randomization factors cancel. Now, in the continuum, that is the case, but on the lattice, nobody really knows for sure. So it could be that everything I showed to you is wrong. And so what is one doing? So one thing is one does the normal, I mean, yeah, I think I will skip the details here. Important is that these are the normal Mellin moments, which you always know, will take, and you know that the Mellin moment of a normal whatever PDS is given by a local operator, a local operator, which therefore doesn't suffer from the fact that we cannot have the same time. And here what you do is in addition that you kind of make a Taylor expansion in your transverse distance, if you want. And then you have basically a double expansion here in the order n of here these derivatives with respect to bt squared and also here in the moment. And that's why these are now double moments, not single moments. Okay, and then we define things which we call shifts by the following. This is something which is has the same m, so it's the same first moment here in x, but one thing has here this a squared in and the other not, and therefore this is something with the dimensions of momentum. And okay, and therefore we call it a shift. Okay, there are some specialities because for the this H1, when you do that, you get something like, it's called a generalized tensor charge. Perhaps I don't have to go into that. However, what is important is that one has to understand that one really has to take these C limits, and that is a real challenge in these simulations. The first one, that goes back to this gauge link, that is a length of the gauge link. So in principle, that has to go through. In praxis, you find that if it's larger than the color correlation length, whatever, somehow it converges, as you will also see the results.
Since you have a periodic lattice, this means you are required that it's larger than.
So you must make the periodic lattice large enough, such that this fits in there. But you will see that is the least of the problems you have. The next thing is that you have to look at, or you must make the lattice spacing so small that in the physical distances you want to probe, you have a sufficient number of things. The reason is that when you have a hypercubic lattice, then if you have only two or three lattice units, then obviously this is not isotropic. we have strong artifacts on this periodic spectrum. And that you see, I mean, you always find that in if you have only two or three lattice spacings, then your results will depend extremely, for example, in which direction some momentum or some distance vector points. And these are typical discretization effects, and they only die out if the distances you want to probe physically are sufficiently much larger than the spacing, like something like 3 or 4 is typically the number. Okay, and then in the end, you have to make the theta going to infinity by making momentum very large, which is a real challenge for reasons I will explain later. And these pictures you have seen, so that is this eta, which you have to make as large as possible. And you see that converges pretty fast. Yeah. So if you are beyond 5 lattice units, or perhaps 10 lattice units, so that is not a problem, and this is done here for Sievers shift, and then you do, and by definition, in one side you have Trajan, so see this situation, and then you still have these other two parameters, theta and eta, which we have not yet taken limits of or whatever. And you do that for all kinds of values for theta. Whatever you can realize on your lattice. And you can do this for Wurmulder shift, so that is here H1 over this F1, always have ratios. And then for the warm gear function, you try to do the same. First of all, this is T even, so it should be the same on both sides. However, I should also say you also compare two different actions, Glover and domain ball fermions, which, as I said, do not have to give the same results, only in the limit A going to 0, if they have to agree. And for example, here, if you look precisely, you see it's not really exactly the same for the warm gear function. But this is something one has to understand. The other thing you would like to understand is this funny behavior here. Okay, so we will come back to that. So there are discrepancies between Glover and domain wall fermions. Now, choosing these two is actually pretty clever. It's not always my decision, of course, but the MIT group mainly, because domain wall fermions have pyrosymmetry but are expensive. So typically, statistical errors are larger, but they have good pyrosymmetry. Glover are cheaper, you have smaller error bars, but you can encounter problems because you violate symmetry. Okay, and then you have this transversity that's also a T even function. Okay, now before I come back to this funny signals, let me look at this P-perp depends, we still have theta and P-perp, so now what we do is we look at this as a function of P-perp for a given Collins sofa. And then what you see here, that is Glover and domain wall fermion. Here, this is where you might think that discretization effects are large, so you would prefer not to take that into account, but here you have results which are nicely compatible between sections. So you would say that here A is already fine enough, you get a reasonable estimate. And then you do the same for, and here it's only plotted for Clover, because as I said, domain wall fermions are more expensive, error bars are larger. So if you make theta larger, or in general, whatever theta, I mean, just the error bars are larger, and so here you take Clover where you have smaller error bars. And then what you see is theta has to go to infinity, and what you see here is that already something like 0.32 seems to be pretty close to infinity. So that's good news because you don't need arbitrary large pz. I mean, you still want to make pz as large as possible. But it could also have been that you have to go to 100, no, to reach the global line. That would have been.
But in the case of cozy PDF, you need a match. The limit of theta to infinity is not the same as theta equals to. There is a match, but here you.
Now I'm a bit confused. I mean, in principle, you really need this limiting curve, no? Yeah, and that's it. I mean, for these ratios of, I mean, we are not looking at a function really. We are only looking at ratios of double moments.
In the ratio of the normalization coefficients.
That's what we assume. As I said, I mean, we assume that you have factorial normalization and that these factors are canceled. And that is, as I said, is a crucial assumption which can be right or wrong. Yeah.
In this space, it works pretty well.
In the continuum.
In the continuum.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's the point. Yeah. But here we are on the lattice.
Right.
And so I guess you have to look. Hmm? And that's what I want to come to because that is what we are doing.
But yeah, you're somewhat assuming that the matching is just the coefficient one, and then you need to check it.
Yeah, but here these are really just these double moments of normal PDB, so it's not quasi.
No, I was just trying to translate the quasi PDB language.
But I think that's different. They're not on the light cone, and they're trying to go to the light cone. Here it's just whether this number is wrong.
Yeah.
Slightly different.
You say you have an analytic function of theta, and this is one analytic function. And how you make theta large for mathematics is completely irrelevant. Yeah? Only the value of this number counts. Yeah? Yeah? And if you are lucky, meaning that this converges already at rather small theta, yeah? Then this works. Yeah? If you're unlucky, it doesn't work. Yeah? But luckily, it seems to work. Okay, I have more of these, but I'm running out of time. So I will rush you through these. And what you see is actually here, for example, that Bohm-Mulder shift as a function of theta for given B transverse. And you see that looks pretty flat. Yeah? And again, Glover and domain wall fermions are completely consistent, so you would say, okay, that is the value of the ratio of double moments. No? And I rush over these, and then here some clever people in our collaboration have tried to estimate at which value of theta in real experiments, so you never have infinite momentum. Really, you might be sitting at this Collins super parameter, and that's also not infinite. No? I mean, that depends on, I don't know exactly which experiment we have looked at here, but typically it's also not infinite. Okay, now I said the important point is that you can realize arbitrarily large momentum, and that is a great problem up to a clever idea that Musch had. No? And then we work this out together. The problem is the following. When you put your source somewhere on the lattice, typically you smear it because you want to get maximum overlap with the state you're really interested in. For example, if you want to have a nucleon, you typically smear that over the distance of the nucleon diameter or something. Now, if you do that in position space, that means that momentum space, you have also something like a Gaussian, and then it's true that you have arbitrarily large momentum in there somewhere, but it's really suppressed. And if you try to do it with brute force, people have produced millions of configurations, but you really run against wall. And the observation by Bernd Musch was that when you smear that on this distance, you can superimpose a plane wave. And then when you Fourier transform that, you get a shifted Gaussian. And like that, it's very easy to generate large momentum. doesn't work infinitely long, because if the momentum becomes too large, the difference in energy between different states becomes smaller and smaller. Yeah, because it's always square root of p squared plus m squared. And we needed, however, this difference to filter out the right one from the very beginning. So this doesn't work forever, but you can realize the QGP. Okay.
Can you do that at both ends, source and sink? Or?
Yeah, that depends a lot on what you're exactly doing. I mean, normally what you do is sequential sources, and you put only the source, and you create the sink, and then you do sequential propagate, and then evaluate software. But that depends on what you're doing. In fact, I will never get there, but for DPDs, we have many different paths. Yeah, and there for each path, we do it in a different way. Yeah, so, okay, now I want to say speak about something new, which we haven't yet done. We just got a few weeks ago the computer time to do it. Mm-hmm. And that is that, one of the crucial points of TMD is that you have this non-perturbative contribution to ability. What I want to say is actually that was worked out in this nice paper by Ignacio and Alexei, and they fitted all kinds of data on vector boson production at very high energies, and they introduced their phenomenological description of these non-perturbative terms in terms of this d function, and that went like that. This is a d function, which is a perturbative part, and then something non-perturbative. In addition, here we have this function fnp, which has two more parameters. And the idea here is that if you look at TMDs, you have really perturbative regions in where things evolve perturbatively, but you have also contribution from regions where it's non-perturbative. And when you do the fits, actually, you find that these parameters are not really zero. Yeah? I mean, that's the result of their paper. They're very poorly known. The experimental, these are here, these errors are relatively small, but the theoretical uncertainties from varying the scale and so on is relatively large, but it doesn't really look, zero would be here, yeah? It doesn't really look as if these things would be zero. So you really want to know what it is exactly, and that is the last thing I'm going to tell, and unfortunately we will not learn about the beautiful things one can say about double distributions. So that is the idea of CLS. CLS, as I said, works with open boundary conditions. That solves the problem of topological freezing, because topological charge can simply fall off the lattice. No, it's just open on both sides, and time can just fall off. Yeah? And then topological charge changes. It means that these boundaries of your lattice cannot really be used because they are laid by artifacts, but that only increases cost by 20-30%. That's not a big thing. And you have to reinvent the normalization techniques, because they're typically based on periodic boundary conditions. That's all done. No? So that was worked out, everything. And then we have generated a large set of configurations. Actually, we have three such sets. One is where the sum of the quark masses up, down, and strange is kept fixed. One is where the strange quark mass is kept fixed. And the reason is that, as you can imagine, lattice computations become expensive when A gets smaller and smaller, and also when the mass becomes, the final mass or quark mass becomes smaller and smaller. So the physical point is reached when the pion gets its real mass. But what we are really interested in is the continuum limit. So we don't want to waste too much computer time with always going to the physical mess. And therefore, the ensembles we have do not really, I mean, we make a few with physical mass, just that we can say that we have ensembles down to physical mass, but then we use chiral perturbation theory to really extrapolate, and then these things have actually not the highest weight. But all of that allows us here to go to ever finer lattices. No? And that's really the whole idea of this collaboration. And this is, as I said, a collaboration of collaboration. Everybody contributes to generating these ensembles, which will also, in due course, be made publicly available to everybody. And the physics analysis is done independent. Okay, and then the idea or suggestion from Alexei was that, okay, if we can calculate these double moments, then we can look at ratios of these double moments for different theta parameters. As I said, that's what we can calculate. And if we do that, then actually that should scale always like that, independently of which dimensions we use. And the perturbative thing is known, that is this thing here. And therefore, if you can measure that, then you can read off a non-perturbative. So that's the aim of that. And for that, we actually do not use the lightest masses, but we use this series of masses where we are starting out here now, and but we can go on to really fine lattices, and even I hope that there will be even additional ensembles by the time we get there. And that gives you a very nice lever arm to really pin down the dependence. Oops. Exactly. And there we just got space time to actually do that. Now, here I would really invite everybody who has a good idea what else we could do, to test scaling behavior, to contact me. I should also say, if this minimalization is non-factorial, we would also find some funny behavior here. So this also tests this assumption that all these factors cancel.
What do you mean by non-factorial?
If the Okay, then perhaps one very last thing, because you have heard already so much about quasi PDFs, and then I really stop. My personal view in that, which might be completely wrong, is that if you simply look at what you can do, what you find is that in some cases, like for the nucleon, it seems to work. So this is LP3 collaboration, that's where Tanong G belongs to. So this is actually not the latest. I mean, the latest plots look even nicer, but they are not yet published. So it's this one. But they, for the nucleon, you always get results which look surprisingly good. Everybody who does it gets surprisingly nice looking results. However, that should not, you should not believe that that means that you know what you are doing. And that you can tell by looking at other quantities. Yeah? For example, distribution amplitude, because there you find that you get artifacts here. I mean, the normal support is only between 0 and 1. But if you do this quasi distribution amplitude procedure, you get artifacts here, and therefore also here the normalization pops, because it's normalized. It's normalized. However, I mean, there are things which are extremely clean, like the idea by Thorn and Miller, and we did that naturally also. I mean, they convinced us that this is the only way to do. And then we really made an enormous effort to calculate that, and then we get data points like that. And I have not the time to explain what is here shown. But in principle, you want to separate various curves which look like that by these data points. And what here Zhanhui Chang has done is he has taken this head curve and with this result recalculated what you would get here, and you get the blue curve. And basically, whatever you do here, you get always something which is compatible with data. So it seems that you can do things which are nicely under control, but really not very sensitive to the information you want to have. Or you have something which is highly sensitive, but not really under control.
Where's the bell curve? Sorry?
Pardon? These are just some model distribution amplitudes I have put in there.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm not sure whether this is this famous gamma, gamma, star, pion. I don't know exactly where I came from. And then there are cases where things don't work, like for the pion. Hmm? I mean, here's one, and if you do that on face value, it looks like that. And my feeling is that you really have to understand all this. You have to understand what really causes these problems, and then you have to understand why these problems are not there in the nucleon and not just by sheer luck cancel. And however, I think that over the next years, much will be learned along this way. And I would hope that it all works out nicely in the end, but that's a long to-do list. So that's my personal view of that.
Stupid curiosity. Is there a reason why the quasi-PDFs, not only the pi, but also for the input, are always plot on a linear scale in X instead of the logarithm, which should be more natural if we want to compare to the normal extractions or parameterizations? They're always plotted.
I'm a bit confused. PDFs, you typically plot
No, on a linear scale. On the x-axis, you have a linear scale.
There's a reason.
If you plot it on a linear scale, you would have.
Now I understood the question, and then I can give you an answer. The answer is that the small x behavior will never be under control. Yeah,
sure. But if you stick to the right part of the plot, then you would emphasize the problems. If you're on a log scale, you are all hidden in that.
No, it's a log scale. It means that you would show in much more detail the small x region.
Exactly.
Yeah. But here you don't trust
this
anyway, because that would correspond to, it takes a Fourier transform to very large. No, and you see that also here, because I mean these are then the anti-quark contributors. You see enormous error bars, and I think therefore, because in principle somewhere at really small x,
is this actually the problem of pions?
Yeah, I have no idea what it is. You know, I mean, at some point we were thinking perhaps. I mean, first idea was the mass, so that's not the reason. I don't know exactly the value. Then the idea was, don't look so angry. and then it was the idea that by having smearing, it's Gaussian, there is not one way to define quality. Yeah, you can define infinitely many, and you have different matching functions. So by making a cleverer choice, you could. But then seems also that this depends really on the randomization scheme. So it's really work in progress.
Yeah. Okay,
that's the question I was asking for. Because a few years ago, that was a big debate. Yeah. What is really the pion PDF? And now I can cite Werner again. The point is that if you look at the Fermi data and you did an NLO fit, it looked as if this would be k close to x being 1, like 1 minus x. Yeah. Like really straight line. I mean, there's some, okay, you don't see that, but like that, yeah. I mean, which would be very surprising. And normally, you would have been pretty sure that should be at least 1 minus x squared, yeah, something like that. And then, okay, we did the calculation, which basically Werner did, or yes, Eicher, or whatever, with threshold resummation. It turned out that threshold resummation really changed this completely, because then if you do this resummed, you really get the perfect description of the data with something which has a smooth behavior. And the reason is that if you do only NLO, you get something like that, so you fall behind the data, and therefore you increase this artificially at large x, compensate, and that gave this form. But then there were zillions of papers where people somehow managed to explain why it should be like 1 minus x.
There's a naive question. So, what was the input from the fit from those data?
Yeah, it says fit to those data, but yeah. So, let me explain this again. These are the data from Fermilab. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so if you do threshold resummation, one of our best fits would be the red line.
Right.
If you would take the parametrization of that, which is NLO, but would not do resummation, then you would end up here. So if you do not resummation, you would conclude that this is not correct, and you would increase this. Yeah? You would increase your PDF at large x, and that resulted in this funny shape. And there is some truth to that, because you also see that the dependence of the renormalization scale, here you have q half and here you have 2q, the dependence on the renormalization scale for the resummed actually becomes very small, while for the NLO, it blows up at x close to 1, which tells you already that there's something not on the So it makes all great sense, but that is why PyAM PDF is really an interesting concept to look at. And therefore, that's why we also looked at that and were pretty shocked that it doesn't look nicer. Yeah? But I think that's the status of the whole thing. On the other hand, and these are now really the last words, I mean, we are supposed to make contact with EIC. Yeah? And the EIC is supposed to be the machine to measure. If you speak with Elke about what experiments really can realistically do, and if you see how complicated functions all these TNDs are, yeah, I very much doubt that you can really pin down any of these with the precision you would like to see. And therefore, I think the future lies in the combination of lattice and experiment, no? Not either or, but both together. However, there is a big problem with the lattice. Namely, that because if you have a hypercubic lattice, your symmetry group is much smaller than in the continuum. You have far less operators in your basis in which you can expand operators. And therefore, if you look at a physical correlation function or operator, you find that normally, I mean, as soon as you go to higher moments where you have more indices and thus higher representations, there are several continuum operators which look like the same lattice operator. And therefore, that's what is called operator mixing. And if you are unlucky, or that is not only unlucky, but typically if you go high enough in your moment, what always happens is that you couple to an operator with a lower energy dimension, where this lack of energy dimension is made up by factors of 1 over lattice spacing. And then you have to take the limit A going to 0, and you encounter a problem. And all of that means that I think more than second derivative, let's see, the first 3 moments, no? More, I don't think is very, very hard. And that means you get 3 numbers per quantity. That's all you can hope for. And I also doubt that this will be sufficient to really pin down PMD set. PIC. And therefore, I think you really need some clever way to get more information. And that is the reason why I think one should really do one's very best to make any of these methods work. And I think that whether you do quasi-PDFs or pseudo-PDFs or current-current correlations, I mean, one should try everything and then see with which one can most efficiently get additional information. I don't know how you see that, but...
I agree.
Yeah.
It's like
a measure one cannot waste any source of information. Yeah? One really wants to fulfill the task or the aims of the EIC. Mm-hmm. One needs any information. Something but not.
I take a couple of questions more than that.
Is the moment for the helping tree on the sample? Or is this something that is not being published? So, I know that for phenomenology we post those numbers, so typically.
I don't know. I honestly can't say. I mean, it's weighted with X, so whether some will fulfill depends very much on these things, where these dashed things lie above. I really don't know. No? I cannot say.
Would you
I would hope that it is imposed.
Can you impose it on the lattice, or is that something that you can?
No. Only get after you have convoluted with the matching function to calculate this continuum. Huh? You calculate on the lattice, you get your quasi PDF, but then you convolute with this matching function. And this is then what you get for the supposedly physical PDF.
For this bridge amplitude, you do have a convolution, but for current speed, you don't. For this special M2, you showed the previous transparency, you do have no correlation. This one.
Yeah, what he says is that the total momentum actually should be one.
No, this is a balance, right? So
Okay, good. And not one. Yeah.
Another question.
At the beginning, we were explaining that one less the time propagating large enough, you basically kill all the higher components in your exponent so that you pick up only the information on the ground state, because the others are suppressed. Now, I would like to understand what does it mean that one of the source of errors of lattice computations is mixing contaminations with a higher resonance state.
Yeah.
If you, it doesn't mean that you didn't propagate too long your
Yeah, exactly. That is the point. The question is always, how do you find out when you have done this far enough? And this is a bad example. Typically, you see that this really comes down like that. However, this is highly often non-trivial, because typically you have still a very slight shift in your value. However, with an error bar.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it becomes a very subjective decision. I mean, I've seen cases where it looks as if it would converge, but then still it made something like that also. So, and therefore people have come up with very sophisticated techniques to test for these things. But the main thing is that the source and the sink are elongated. I mean, just move apart such that they have a longer time. But then the larger this distance is, the smaller your signal gets. Yeah?
Yeah.
Sometimes you lose your signal. So, yeah, nothing is for free in this business. because that is perhaps a misunderstanding also. You can not only look at the those states. You can do something that's called generalized eigenvalue, which means that you also normalize states to different eigenvalues, and that allows you in real life to get a few of the low line doesn't have the source.
Okay, so let's thank Andreas again. We move to the last talk of the afternoon, and I thank the